Welcome everybody here to your ESWC Qualifiers Grand Final for the Eastern Qualifier, where MUFC and Orange have fought their way through a whole bunch of teams open sign-up to get themselves here into the last two positions. It is a best of five qualifier, so without further ado, let's jump ourselves in. Of course, good morning and welcome to everybody around the world, good afternoon to everybody across Southeast Asia. It's great to have everybody tuning in here for today's broadcast. Of course, we should have ourselves an amazing match. Orange yesterday performing absolutely brilliantly. You gotta say almost a flawless performance by them coming through the grid. And well, there's also just great control coming out from Orange. Like, you watched them play throughout the entire of yesterday, and it was always about controlling farm, controlling the lanes, and making sure they capitalized on all the map controls. So when they got it, they used it. We saw so many times Orange pushing out the towers on the enemy jungle air on enemy jungle lane, so their long lane, and then just control the jungle from there, farming two separate sets of jungle while still controlling the lanes and looking for kills. It was a really fantastic play. Of course, MUFC, they're no mugs to be messed with as well. As far as their progression coming through this group, they did have themselves a little bit of trouble in their quarterfinals up against NTSG and then up against EVO GT. They took it 2-0 very, very quickly. TNC actually put up more of a fight to Orange than EVO GT did to MUFC, just because, well, let's just say it was a faster game between MUFC and EVO GT. But we are here in the grand final. Both teams, well, they're looking good. Let's hope they're going to look amazing when they play this best of five. Of course, there is no one game advantage. There is no double elimination. It will be either your full five games or basically first person to three is the way this all goes down. So let's jump ourselves and look at the draft is the best place to kick off. So Nagasaren as well as Templar Assassin being banned out. And interesting that HYHY is still going to go with Lycan. By the way, if you ever notice, HYHY doing the draft right now for MUFC. Sharky, Ken, Net as well as Oi. They all be playing in the team as well, obviously, because they're from MUFC. As far as Orange go, it is their full lineup. Extinct, Yamata, Winter, Ice as well as KYXY. Playing for them. Darkseer as well as they just profit also making the pool, ban pool. But it's just as far as Lycan goes, a lot of people have kind of given up on Lycan. Lycan's no longer first ban or first pick material for so many people, mainly just because of the huge change that happened to Lycan, whereas Wolves basically cost so much, they got less life, they do have higher magic resistance, but it just does mean that you can't run Lycan in the jungle. He's too expensive and you can't... It is impossible. Obviously, MUFC might be able to prove me wrong, but as far as the changes go, there's just no way that Lycan can really legitimately jungle over the top of, like, other junglers as well. If he runs back to base, makes new wolves every single time, then maybe, maybe. But it's very, very difficult for him to do so. So Lycan on lane is the only real options that MUFC have. Even Lycan on the off lane is not really doable. Also because, like, you could pull with the wolves, but they just cost you so much. They cost you so much that there's so little you can do.
Tidehunter.
Dire team pick.
Ohio. Really? That's how you say his name, I'm guessing. Thanks very much to Terry. Sorry. I don't think he likes when I call him Oi. Ohio. Ohio is the way we pronounce that, MUFC. Awesome. Fantastic, Terry. Rubick, Queen to Pain, as well as Tidehunter coming up here for Orange.
10 seconds remaining.
So Rubick, always a quality pickup when you got anything on the field, really. And also nice mid-solo if you're ever going to feel like you're going to be outdone. But then he can also switch himself into a support role. Can couple up with heroes like Lashrak, Lina, anything which is just a high damage stun, which just requires a small amount of setup, which can come through the telekinesis. Tidehunter as well, so Orange already controlling a lot of their team fight. Gives them an offlane potential as well through the Tidehunter, or as we said before, another support. But Queen of Pain, also the kind of same thing. Orange, they've got their first three pickups, and all three pickups are able to do multiple roles in any kind of lane. So MUFC banning against this can be very, very difficult. All they can do is, at this point, Venom. Ban out the hard carries they don't want Orange to be playing. So we're talking Morphling, we're going to be talking any kind of, like, any mage. If you want to remove him out, that's all MUFC can really remove. And, well, Beastmaster being removed out here by Orange. So they're looking already to the offlane of MUFC, knowing that Lycan cannot run it. Venomancer also the pickup here from HYHY. So supporting the top lane. It's going to make Tidehunter's job a lot more difficult. Can't really get in nice and close on that lane. And because of that, it's like, well, what are you really going to be able to do with the Tidehunter on the offlane? SF being banned out here by HYHY. And quite legitimately is what Yamatai was going yesterday in that very, very one-sided game, which was pretty impressive still. The level of farm and also just the power of Shadow Fiend. We saw it so early on. So now we go through our last set of bans. So banning out, again, still, carries MUFC to remove, Orange. Are they going to cripple the offlane a little bit more? Look for that Windrunner ban. Don't know what else you really want to ban on the offlane.
10 seconds remaining.
Something with an escape mechanism. Ban out that Puck. Remaining. There's no point in banning out Puck. Actually, Puck would be a decent ban, but not going to happen. They ban out the Lone Druid instead. Have that tanky bear that's always able to pull through. An Orange. Well, not wanting to deal with that. They won't have to. Chaos Knight also going to be banned here by HYHY.
Oranges turn to ban.
So setup stun I was talking about, but then again, they already had that from Rubick. So his telekinesis pick up and then throw down. There's still going to be one more ban out here from Orange. And I am expecting the Windrunner ban. Because I already know the cause. Unless they want to ban out of the jungle, let's take out that Enigma. But then again, they don't want to really take out Enigma. Because if Enigma comes up, then Rubick's like, sweet, I get myself some really nice abilities. What else do I really need? It works quite nicely for him, so maybe ban out the tree, ban out the offlane tree and protector. No, they are still going to ban out the Enigma. Damn you to hell. So Enigma has been banned out here by Extinct, which leaves HYHY with his final ban, and also forced into the only offlane pick he can go. And maybe Orange are happy with that. There's the Chen ban out, because we have seen Chen, he played up yesterday. Obviously, always played to perfection, but has been reworked with the 6.75 changes. So because of that, it's he costs his mana pool needs to be a lot larger when you look at the Chen. Can't spam off multiple abilities during a team fight. It's quite annoying, in fact. So yeah, Chen gonna make his way to the ban pool. Also, a small animation change as far as the Test of Faith goes. For the Sendback ability, it's very difficult to recognize it.
Windrunner at your
well,
service.
Extinct even going to block MUFC for that offlane, so they wanted the Windrunner themselves. So Windrunner for their offlane, which does put Rubick and Tidehunter into a support role. Queen of Pain to go that solo mid-up against the Invoker. Interesting to see if Tidehunter does actually... It's a weird kind of lane. It's almost like Extinct want to run Tide as that offlane solo, because they've already assuming that Lycanthrope is going to be up on that top lane for MUFC. And with that, Tide won't be too fussed by that. You have Anchor Smash, he'd be able to survive up against the Wolves, as well as Lycan himself. Shouldn't be much of a problem. The only problem would be the Venomancer. But maybe then we look at the aggressive tri-lane. Windrunner, she's been part of those many, many times. We see Phase Boots, Windrunner very early on. Gives good right-click, gives good follow-through. And can combine with the Rubick as well as Tidehunter. So HYHY, he's kind of forced into the situation to pick up the Bounty Hunter for the offlane. And if Orange really want to stick it to him, then we'll see like a Slaughter come out. It's a nice way to get through Lycan as well. Nice way to keep up with Lycan. For guys in chat too, I've actually sent an invite out to Draskal. But yeah. No response. As always, guys, as always. Always see if I can find you an awesome co-caster that can join me. In this scenario, though, yeah, none of them have responded. So if you want to spam the living crap out of them, I would be much, like, go nuts. Happy to have any kind of guest on the live stream. So Orange, who was going to be your last pickup? Some guy with strength, some guy with initiation, some guy with a stun. Would be really, really nice. And that's not any of those. So Broodmother will be the selection, which kind of screws us up a little bit. It could still be Rubick or Windrunner as a core. It could just be a support Windrunner. Broodmother to run the offlane, but picking up the Broodmother after Bounty Hunter has already been selected, it's rather unusual pickup. So it's got to be Broodmother on the safe lane. It's the only way this can really happen. Well, then again, maybe... It's okay for Broodmother in the early levels because Bounty Hunter won't have track. But you know this entry ward's going to come down and Venomance is going to push you off the lane. Yeah, thanks to the guy out there that says Toby Solocast is the best. I know what the pros bring, man. I know what the pros bring. And it's always good to have them.
I am Shadow Shaman.
And there's Shadow Shaman pick up from MUFC. So holds the Bounty Hunter like it, as well as Invoker will be their cause. Very, very predictable lanes coming out here from MUFC. My Venomancer and Shadow Shaman going to be pulling in the jungle as well as supporting on the top lane. Lycan having to be on lane because of the changes which did come recently. And that's going to put Aureli into the Invoker middle solo role. And Bounty Hunter down towards that bottom lane. KYXY is a Broodmother. And Yamatai, Queen of Pain. Let's just see if KYXY, he keeps on going mid-solo for Orange Esports, and we might see him do the same with Yamatai getting to go the easy lane, which puts Ice on the Windrunner, and that's the support Windrunner in this case. And do we see Yamatai try and go offlane? Let's just wait and see what they do. There's so many options for Orange Esports right now. So we'll see what they decide to do, and we'll check out our laning as far as our MUFC goes to start with. So HY, they're standing for this evening. He'll be taking up the role as Lycanthrope. We have Aureli, Invoker, coming down the middle. And that's going to put Ken onto the Bounty Hunter, heading down towards the off lane. Sharky will be our Venomancer, and that leaves our final but not least, Net, who will be taking up the role as Shadow Shaman. So one of these two boys will be rotating top. And judging by the large amount of tangos on the Invoker, I'm wondering if it's even going to be him. He's not bottle rushing, and HY has spent absolutely nothing. Creates one set of wolves, and there we go already with noticing just how much mana these wolves take. They've only got 200 life points. And HY loses almost his entire mana pool by doing it, because he hasn't bought any items yet. And that could be the reason why. Wolves having a little bit of a scat out to the lanes, but they're a little bit too late. Orange are already moving through the jungle of MUFC, putting up the wards, because they realize if they're going to run Lycan as well as two support heroes that want a jungle, it's... Oh, extinct. Got to get the pick up. Telekinesis, got to work right now. Going to pull Sharky back in. There's your Gush. Power shot as well. Good early damage, and Ned can just sit here and watch, and that's going to be it. Gale will go, but Tyon's axe being long enough to get the last right click in. So first blood is there, and one last ward will be planted down by Extinct. And that's going to block both the camps, both this camp and this camp, is how you pull up the lane. And they're not going to realize this till 30 seconds, so the double stag is not going to happen. Net has no sentry wards. In fact, does anybody have sentry wards? No, they don't. They can't do anything about this until they're able to find 200 gold. And that's a long way off for both the support players. HY, he's going to bring up Ring of Basilius. But starting off with that Ring of Protection just so he can live. And it's going to be an aggressive tri lane on top. So as expected, Ice will be the one who will be getting a lot more farm up on that Windrunner. Look for the early phase boots as well as that Ring of Aquila. Maybe, but probably not. Just Ring of Basilius will be enough early on. Get some nice mana for everybody else in the neighborhood. It's going to be a very difficult lane for HY. The magical damage is there, but it's the physical damage which can come out from Windrunner once she's got those phase boots up. Now these wolves just can't deal with it. HY pulled down. Nice Gale, but it's not going to be enough. Windrunner was not caught in it. So it's another kill now going the way of Orange. Sharky trying to bring down Extinct. But this top tri lane is just too aggressive for a dual lane to deal with. They thought Orange might have just been going, be Broodmother up here, be offlane Tidehunter. But they weren't expecting it all, and they weren't expecting to be shut down at every single camp, so they can't pull and they can't control. But even then, the control coming out from Extinct, he picked him up when he was here. So you can't even go past this line of farm and you're a melee hero. And even that Extinct is cutting a short path through here, so he's able to pick up from this region. Sharky, just staying out of range of that telekinesis. But this top lane for MUFC is basically a disaster right now. I have managed to deward, so I'm assuming... Nope. Yeah, they did. One Dire Sentry Ward, just in this little region here. So they have been able to get rid of it. Now the Gush, telekinesis, pick up again. Power shot, already helping them off. Gale hit on top of Extinct, but it doesn't stop him from right-clicking him down. And now they go to the next one. Net, pick off hero after hero. Everyone's getting to die on this top lane. Venomancer twice. It's just the Shadow Shaman that hasn't. And they've got to think about a change-up now. Ken's in the bottom lane, up against KYXY. He's already got his Soul Ring. So he's looking great. 15 for 2. Up against 12 for 1, though. A Bounty Hunter. He does have a lot of Spilings he can kill off, but still his last sitting's looking pretty damn good. Problem he's going to have is, when KYXY just starts harassing him with Spider levels, Ken's going to lose so much. He's only got one salve left, so consumables are pretty damn low. Kind of wishes he had... Well, actually, no, he does have 2 points in Shuri Toss. There's just spiders after spiders on that bottom lane. But they're worth a lot more money now. So Bounty Hunter won't be too sad about it. How's our middle lane looking? Queen of Pain, 11 for 7, up against 9 for 5 Invoker. It could be worse. But that's definitely not Invoker winning the lane until this kind of thing happens. Got to be careful of that cold snap. Yamatai kind of knew he still had that bottle charge up his sleeve and going to send it back with the courier. But that's going to be all. 1437 is going to be proud. I was talking about the problem yesterday. I don't know which match it was the aggressive tri-lane that was attempted. Ah, who was that by? I think it was actually by TNC, where they tried the aggressive tri-lane on top. But they never contested this pull. And when the ward is gone, you've got to contest that pull. They got to get themselves in deeper as well, Sharky. We got another ward to come out in the moment here from Extinct. He's got one sentry up his sleeve. But these support heroes are finally able to pull and get some levels very early on. Hedra was kind of lucky that didn't pop his clarity then. I also want to check out what build he's going to go. So look at this path, which has just been cut straight up. I think he's still going to get rid of this tree on the side. Once he's got rid of that, he's fine. Well, a couple of walls being created. Extinct going to throw it down. Shackle out in him. And this could be the first kill. Going to go the way of MUFC. Yep, Extinct will go down. That'll be at the cost of HY. Maybe even Winter. Winter's trying to stick on the back of Ned. And Ice with a right-click damage is going to be enough if he can keep up with it. And now the Wolves trying to get in front. Nice Shackle by Ice. Power shot as well. He's copying too much. Shackle is there by Ned. Nice turnaround from MUFC. Again, though, they did lose the Lycan, and this is not what they want to have happen, especially when HY didn't spend any of his money. What he ended up having was 800 gold, and he ended up dying, so he only had about 500 at the end of it. For people asking to clear it up, if it is actually HY, yes, it is actually HY. The guys in the chat that are wanting to know that. It is, in fact, HY. The man from Singapore. The man formerly of Zenith.
Dire structures are fortified.
So Ice. It's not him. It's Ice.
Dire's
different Ice.
Tower is under attack.
Counter warning already starting off as well here from Orange. Just wanting to clear out, make sure they're not being watched where they're rotating, where they're moving. Because they're now being watched by a different ward. One up on the high ground here. And because of that, Net just moving back a little bit further. Sharky now trying to find some levels. And this is what... Man, HY. He's managed to get 2 levels up in his wolves. But this is really not sustainable in the jungle. Top lane going to get the kill on Sharky. And Net's forced back. They realize Lycan's gone. Lycan's trying to find his quick farm in the jungle. Get towards that Vlad's if possible. But he's just so far away. And these wolves... This is the problem. He's trying to kill off the stack right now, but the wolves just aren't strong enough. He's completely out of mana. And look at this wolf, it's already down half life. He's forced to pull it out again. There's no lifesteal coming out from it. And because of this, you have to micro your wolves even harder than you normally would. Just in order to keep them alive while they try and farm. And this is the reason why a lot of people have just given up on Lycan as far as jungle goes. Winter as well is extinct. Looking to just make a little bit of a buffer. There's a pickup on one of the wolves. Just going to pick it up and throw it down. And then, MUFC again finding the wards. Able to deward Orange out. Nice is enjoying herself. And not surprisingly, considering there's such a mana intensive support heroes up in this top lane. He buys mana boost. Instead of going to go the physical damage, going to give mana to everybody. He's the one they've been putting the farm onto. Sitting at 1k worth of gold in his bank account. And Tide, as well as Rubick, both are able to get arcane boots and about 300 gold. They can look for HY, and Extinct. Might even get his best moment of his life right now. Like, Wolf, maybe Bolt? No, just get the last hit. That'll be fine. But this tri-lane can't pull. It can't gank. It's just being shut down. The only thing it could do, and did pretty well when it happened, was counter-ganking. So an Orange trying to extend on them into a position they probably really couldn't have. That's when MUFC pounced. HY is getting closer and closer to that Vlad's. Bit by bit. Even the Kobold camp is proving difficult for these wolves. I gotta check out the lanes because it's getting too depressing watching that.
Denied.
But they're really up against the Yamatar in the middle lane also. It's not really anybody wanting to cash themselves out of position or go too far. Battle of the Invis in the bottom lane. Everyone's about running away, including Ken right now. Well, at least has himself some Tranquil Boots, so he could deal with the harassment. He can't do it always. Those Tranquil Boots do have themselves a decent cooldown on them. But then again, Sol Ring also. A bit of a larger cooldown. I mean, the 30-second cooldown on the Sol Ring now means the consistent harassment that can come out from the Broodmother. So just convert your life, get your mana, and then get your life back from your level 4 webs. If you just keep on wanting to find level 4 spiderlings into the chest of your opponent. And that burst damage just slowly whittles him down and gives you an opening to attack. They're really going to rotate up towards the top lane. There's a whole bunch of spiders following him. They know exactly what's going on. It's like, hey guys, Invoker, get back. Or maybe at least a way for him to overextend. Maybe that's also why Yamatar's moved up. Now at level 8, this is a dangerous, dangerous time for MUFC. Especially considering Queen of Pain's managed to get that point booster. So as mana, not only for a combo, but also for a secondary harassment. So a second Blink and Scream if she wanted it. And running the bottle on top of that. If he wanted to, could nuke down to a point. Really with 910 HP. Wouldn't be enough to instantly kill him off. If you had something like an Orchid and the Malevolence, then yeah, probably would be. Now, a full lane rotation, HY, he does have the Vlad's finally. And moves towards that bottom lane. Get to create the Wolves, and we'll probably want to go Roshan, but he can't early level Roshan, again, because of the changes to the life points of the Wolves. It's not really doable. Yamatar pushing the middle lane. They're maybe able to get that Hex out on him. And shut him down. Really? Trying to look for the lock and net. Not able to get close enough for the Hex. And the Spiders gave a good buffer, but it's all distraction. Spiders help push the middle lane. It's just one hero, Yamatar. And they've brought so much assistance! Sharky nailed in the middle lane. The track is there. Shuri toss won't hit. Wrong time to throw when he's up in the air. You can't kill him in the tornado. Yamatar, Hex as well. Blink, gonna happen. Couldn't finish him off. 2 seconds. Nice! Just off to the edge. Shuritos hits. He needed like 1.5 seconds so he could blink further. But Ken's able to track him down. But at the same time, Tier 2 tower is going to go down the top lane. And there's nothing they can do about that. And that is that full mech? It's a full mech already purchased up. We're 11 minutes in. IS is able to afford a full mech for his team. So he's already having his arcane boots. In fact, we've got three sets of arcane boots on this top lane. Meanwhile, on the bottom lane, it's like HY trying to push it out, but KYXY can harass him back pretty decently here. Bringing him down low, Soul Ring, and then Spiders. If he chases through the webs, he might be able to get this. The Spiders are still on his tail. And HY forced to pop his ultimate to get himself away. Not what he needs to do. And Ken comes back towards the bottom lane. Even if he tracks up KYXY now, he's going to be in trouble because Extinct comes in. Fade Bolt to start with. Does go invis, but there's no dust, there's no reveal. Just a whole bunch of arcane boots on the bottom lane. Someone might even want to invest in a gem sometime shortly if they want to push out that bottom lane. So they've got to know Ken is watching. And Ken's also got to know with this rotation from Orange that bottom tier 2 tower will be probably one of the next targets. Ice and Yamata, their job will be to control. And here we go again. HY won't be able to get shackled from this. There's no real tree in the line. And he manages to avoid the power shot, but his wolves are gone again. Tornado will fly, only just niggling there on Yamata, but Cold Snap is going to be enough, and it is going to be enough. Meg Charge, is it going to get him out of there? No, it's not. Shackles are there.
That hardly hurt at all.
Shackles from the Shadow Shaman, holding Queen of Pain in position. He's able to keep that Cold Snap going from the Invoker because that he couldn't finish the animation to blink himself to safety. Ice. Power shooting through both the walls as well as HY. Remember, that is magical damage. The wall's not really affected by it too much. It's their upside. 50% resistance when it comes to magical attacks. So I was surprised to see Ice, as well as most of Orange, crank up the arcane boots in that top lane. Where something like phase boots with that right-click bonus damage would have been so perfect. They already had two mana boots coming out from Extinct and Winter, and there's that gem on time. As expected. Looking for Bounty Hunter just to move a little bit out of position. Look, he's also trying to keep it secret as possible. Like Yamatar as well. What was he gonna build to? Most people would just say, yeah, he's building Aghanims. And every single time I talked about this with 1437 yesterday, it was like, yeah, man, it's not going to go Aghanim. It's just a casual point booster. And then he works his way into the Scythe of Ice, just so he can have the health and mana pool. And then he builds the Aghanim Scepter. Fortification trying to stop this top lane push. Because the Amateur, if he wants a good line where he can initiate, and there's the Blink Scream. Just getting rid of the creep wave for now. And Tornado just to harass both the Tide as well as the Queen of Pain. But they don't care too much. As well, there's heroes for MUFC pushing up the top lane. Again, the pressure is added to the bottom. Bit by bit, Broodmother just niggles down towers. Ice, gotta be careful with this middle lane. HYHI would like to force it. And that's the reason why he's the one being harassed. Shackle won't lash, but the mini stun. It was trying to be enough for Yamata to get that sting off and slow him down. But with the Ultimate Form again popped by HYHY in defense, it was just too much. Now the TP support's coming in. Extinct is here, but with three TPs coming in, he may as well just stay here. May as well just stay here and TP out. KYXY, yes, he is visible to Ken. That's not going to be able to get the kill. And now Yamata looking at Ken. KYXY has already returned to this bottom lane. The regeneration he gets now from the mech as well as from his web. 16.8 on the base regen now. This will be tier 2 tower forced down. The EMP tornado. Next thing, still happy to stand inside the EMP. It's just so he can do this. And oh, really? Yamata, big oldie. And then the power shot from Windrunner. The oldie from Queen of Pain was not enough damage to bring down the Invoker. Hence, power shot was required.
Dire's bottom tower.
But they get it nonetheless. At the same time, Lycan trying to find his farm in the middle lane, but not as we expected. Not that powerhouse that Lycan normally is. This being the latest version of Dota 2. There's no big power that comes out from Lycan anymore.
Dyer's top tower.
Now the tier 1 tower in the top lane. Well, a lot of support. It's just a couple of Bounty Hunter illusions. We're just scouting out the movement coming in. H1 still able to bring down that tower. It is a nice power from Lycan, and this was something which I think it was Dryskull I was actually playing with. And found out. Oh no, it was Tides of Time. And he ended up going for a different kind of build to see how it would work. And leveling up Howl to max. Cooldown's not that long, 35 seconds. And you get a nice bonus damage, 12 duration. And it was really, really good when you're pushing down towers. As far as shutting that off, leveling up Howl over everything else, in fact, it worked beautifully. Middle lane push, Winter. So you're still hoping for an opportunity. The guy's got Ravages, hasn't been able to pop it off just yet. Gush out into Ken, Anchor Smash as well. Mini Shackle, Scream as well. They cannot see him, he's managed to go invis. Oh, now he's coming out of it. Four staff up, Yamatai, is he able to get that Scream off? Yes, he can now. Gets the kill on Ken. Sharky trying to harass him back with the Gale. But holding his ulti in for now. Really not feeling that the power's there for his team. And HY trying to add some pressure to that top lane. But Extinct TP's in to stop it. Yamatai getting lucky again. He did finish the Aghanim Scepter. So ulti always available. And the ping's going out. The Radiant Ward watching him. They need to pop the Ravage if they're going to stop him. They do so. Pick out Telekinesis and the Queen of Pain ulti.
Was it really that bad?
Positioning was that bad, Queen of Pain, yes. I'm hoping you guys heard what she said. I'm pretty sure the volume will be that loud. How's KOXY looking in the meantime? Orchid plus having 2,500 gold. Easy initiate. Middle lane push now going to happen as well with double damage on the Queen of Pain. Just right click damage to that tier 2 tower in the middle lane will be enough. Realize there's a whole bunch of plague wards here, but the Kree Wave just bypassed it. Fortifications already forced by MUFC. Ty looking to get in behind. Gush again with the anchor, with a pick up of Telekinesis. Winter right in the front lines. Make sure to keep them all alive for now. Venomancer, of course, being dead for MUFC. Oop, bit of trouble for KYXY, getting himself shackled out by Ned. Then four stars away in Ice. He's stuck for now. Has to do a short-range power shot to get himself away. And Ken will chase him, Shuri Toss. Not really worth it. There was a bit of a body block there, which was not intentional. Two stick charges will have to pop here from Ice if he wants to live now. Three stick charges. No time to four staff, no time for anything else. There's good pickoffs here from MUFC. Started with Broodmother very overextending in the middle lane. And MUFC repel orange. Broodmother just walks straight in here, but wasn't expecting. Sentry wards, but even then, he wasn't invis. He just decided to walk in through the side and try and pop off the Orchid and the Malevolence on something. And if he just planned to die in the middle of it all. And HY starts up on Roshan. Lifesteal from the Wolves is going to be enough for them. And the Hound of Fate, HY is the man who's tanking up most of the damage. Yeah, there's that damage to the Wolves. You can see it there with just one punch from Roshan. So that's the reason why HY forced to tank up. But then again, still able to kill off Lycan, kill off Roshan. Medallion of Courage really helps you out with that one, and Vlad's. So we're now finally hitting that point where Lycan, he's a lot more useful. Even though it still costs a lot more to use what he uses. He's still potent once he gets past that early game. And Orange, they shut him down pretty early on, but they haven't controlled him since then. Up to 94 for one, as far as last hits go. Of course, the top three on the board do belong to Orange. And of course, they'll have a huge gold advantage with the amount of towers they've taken. Yep. No surprise there at all. But this dip back down again, this is when Lycan's able to gain some momentum. Bringing down Roshan, having the Aegis the Immortal, already having his Strength Treads Vlad's as well as a Medallion. These big items can start to roll in for HY. Shadow Shaman's even working in towards four staff. Invoker's already got his. Sharky just praying to live. And Ken, building up to his BKB. When he started off with his drums and tranquil boots, so even if he does come into this top lane, cops a little bit of harassment from Yamata, he won't be too concerned about it. Able to jump in Viz, there's no detection up here on this top lane. That belongs to the Tidehunter, who did manage to escape with the gem before. Alright, so it really just needs himself a moment. It'd be a good time to remind you all, if you are tuning in, this is a best of five matchup for ESWC. It is the qualifier for the Eastern qualifier. Teams are still required to get themselves to France to compete in the final, but this allows them to qualify. And then the West qualifier comes up later tonight. No Tide going up against EG. No Tide able to take out Moscow 5-2-1 last night. A bit of a surprise win for, well, I think everybody. Moscow 5 have been playing so damn well of late that they weren't really expecting No Tide to take it out like they did. But No Tide, they've got a couple of stars in their lineup. At the end of the day, Anti-Mage also. Played by Black. Game is good, and then Anti-Mage in Game 3. But yeah, No Tide able to take out Moscow 5. Their opponents will be the American team. The American team that was denied the ability to play during the American qualifier. Then ESWC changed their rules about what countries can play and the composition of teams, how much of a percentage must be from one country. That was all modified, which meant that EG, as well as the rest of America, was allowed to compete. EG being the only American team that got themselves through into that grand final. And they'll be the guys up against No Tide. They went 2-0 up against CPL, 2-0 up against Gunner. So EG will have the chance to play later on tonight up against No Tide in the best of five. That'll be coming up at 19 CEST, so 7 PM tonight. For people who don't know European time, it's in 5 hours from now. The game shall begin. Of course, Orange versus MUFC must be played out first. Even then, this has been a fun road for them. Orange able to take out Gizmo 2-0, TNC 2-0, because TNC did the surprise not the underdog, but just a surprise team coming out from the Philippines. Able to bring down Mythtrust 2-1. And they played a really, really good game up against Mythtrust. TNC, they're very, very impressive in their style as well as preparation. But when it came to execution, Orange just had that experience over them. So while the strat was normally great from TNC, it's just always, strats are good, execution is required. Orange on the hunt for a kill now, smoked up, looking up the middle lane. At the same time though, MUFC smoke as well. And they're going to all just hit each other. Sharky being picked up, going to be thrown down as well. Shackled towards a tree, already gushed up too. All the hatred coming the way. The Venomancer, four-staff net, trying to get himself in position. And a second four-staff down. Power shot. I always get weird with that animation. Should do damage when it flies like that. That four-star was meant, so net was able to shackle. I think net screamed at the rest of his team, going, no way. I know what's coming in. I don't want to be part of it. It's called Yamata. And he is going to work towards that sheep stick as expected. Medallion already starting up on the Brewmother, but he wants to fall back. And very, very wisely so. Sentry Ward on the Shadow Shaman. Kind of hoping the Brewmother will come in closer. As again, Orange. Going to push out this T1 tower in the middle lane. Pause coming out quickly here from net. As Sharky just DCs with the game. So MUFC just having a couple of issues. Before it was the toilet. And now our Venomancer manages to DC from the game. Also a reminder for people out there, because I know a lot of people from Southeast Asia probably don't know about this show, considering it happens in European time, because it happens every Tuesday night at 22 CEST. But we do upload all the VODs, and the VODs from the latest version are obviously available. In fact, all the weeks have been available. But Talk Dota is every Tuesday night at 22 CEST. It's join Dota's, well, how do we describe it? Your weekly dose of Dota, I think, is the way I describe it every single week. We give you wrap-ups about what's happening in the scene. We also talk about, last week we had the patch log special. It ended up going for 3.5 hours of conversation between Sindarin as well as Puppy about every single change that happened and its effect it would have on the metagame. So if you want to watch that, check out the VODs. You can find them in the VODs section of joindota.com, or you can find them over on our YouTube channel as well, youtube.com/joindota, and you can find it all there. This week we'll be talking to Grey Khan from DreamHack, talking about a couple of fun details about DreamHack, and just what's to be expected at DreamHack, which should be really great. So hopefully, people down in Southeast Asia have heard of that show, and they're also sharing the love of Talk Dota. We're looking for it to become a little bit bigger, than what it already is, and really, hopefully, help bring a bit of discussion, official discussion, to the world of Dota 2, which is the goal behind it, and I hope everyone's been enjoying it so far. But yeah, be on this Tuesday night, every Tuesday night at some 22 CEST is when we try and do it. Sometimes a little bit earlier, sometimes a little bit later. It'll all depend. It just depends on what's happening that night. Of course, what else is coming up? Star Ladder Finals coming up it's in 11 days, I think it is now. 11 days until Star Ladder Finals begins. We'll be giving you all your coverage here at joindota.com as well. It's going to be coming out through English live streams. On this stream you're on right now, you'll find your Star Ladder Finals. And you can find all of your... This is the Dancing Invoker. What the hell? Oh, that's great. What the hell is happening with Invoker? There's the headless Invoker going one way and the other, it's the four staff. It's the four staff back. Man, that looks weird as hell. That looks so bloody weird. It's the smallest things that amuse us here in Dota. It's always wonderful. Alright, so Venomancer is going to restart his PC before he can reconnect back in again. Oh, on the bright side, all he's got to do is just reconnect and he's good to go. four-staff animation. Is everyone else having some fun? Power shot animation, mid go-to. This middle lane scenario is really not the best for Orange. They're starting to get, well, not surrounded because we've got, obviously, illusions. But HYHY is giving some decent pressure towards that bottom lane. And Broodmother, as we saw before, she is not too keen on facing up against HYHY. And then towards that middle lane, we've got Nettie's got Mass Serpent wards. Still got that Hex at level 4. And then his Shackles. But Invoker, just down one ability for now. The Venomancer, desperately trying to defend with Aurea's Fire Plague wards up. But the level 4 wards, difficult guys to bring down. Who's 4 staff? Is that actually 4 staff? He's just walking back. It looks like a 4 staff, but it's not. It's a telekinesis pickup. Yeah. Oh, it's Rubik's ulti. Ah, that's what it is. Rubik casting ulti. So, can 4 staff would go in a straight line, but this turns a corner almost. Rubik's ulti, that makes a lot more sense. Thank you very much to everybody in the chat who's so understanding. I love the Join Dota IRC chat. Always nice. Yes, you don't need to spam or else you get kicked from the chat. It's just what happens to you, man. It's just what happens to you. Also remember too, I'm on a delay. with my delay, it's there's like that 30 seconds before I catch up to you guys or you catch up to me. It's the other way. It's the second one. So for all those guys that that sit there going, "Oh my God, Toby, 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 oh my God, just now get what we're saying, get what we're saying." I get it, man. I get it. Believe me, I get it. And it just takes you 30 seconds to realize that I got it. Oh, man. Well, after the guy is still asking about the Star Destroyer. And that's great. We haven't finished it. It's going to take us a lot longer. But there's been almost all of the exterior work done. And it's just going to be starting on the internal, which is not the easiest thing in the world. And there's a question from Slash. Are you actually retired, man? He's like, I'm just standing in. That's all I'm doing. MUFC. So our Venomancer, as I was saying before, he's re-kicked back into Steam. So we just got to boot into Dota 2. It is a bit of a problem for Southeast Asia. A lot of computers are only just capable of running Dota 2 down there, because not a lot of them are built for to maximum do Warcraft 3. And with all the LAN cafes I spent in, all the time I spent in LAN cafes back in Australia, the cafes are built, the computers are built, so you're only just able to play the games which they install on it. Because if you spend more money, then obviously you're not going to make enough to keep a LAN cafe running. So, what's the game that everybody plays when it comes to Malaysian Dota? It's called Dota. Dota 1, Warcraft 3, Dota. Sometimes I think some people might play that game. But people should be playing Dota. Everyone plays Dota. So you build a computer to do that. That's all the real requirements for it. Oh, man. Alright, so Venomancer up. There we go. Reconnects back into the game. All those guys out there who always do it on the YouTube stuff. It's, oh, God. Thank you very much to Keeper who just linked me that. But Venomancer back inside the game. So we get to roll again. And then instantly pause. It's like, wait, we're not ready yet. We're not ready. He's back in the game, but we're not ready. Oh, wait. Okay, now we're good. He's got a loading screen only. So there's our spell steal. He'll end up stealing that EMP. Scream onto the creep wave, and already Yamatar is moving back a little bit. Realize they lost their own creep wave, so they can't get that pressure on the tower. But they want it dead, and they know the denial was coming, and Sharky gets rid of it. So tier 2 tower, that was the last remaining tower as well for MUFC outside their base. And all they've managed to claim is 2 tier 1s. What's HYHY now? Got BKB, not fully done yet. Still needs another 800 gold before he can do so. And that's going to be his, his first critical item. The Vlad's and Medallion are good, but he still needs the BKB, the critical part of that. Where Yamatar is still working towards, and I'm probably going to shoot there's something on the courier. No, there's not. But he had a little bit more farm than that. But Aghanim Scepter and Ultimate Orb. As our TP is coming bottom lane. HYHY wanting to push, but the track is up on Broodmother. Got all the vision in the world on him. Got to be careful about him and not to give away that track. So by giving away that track, he's gonna be completely revealed. And then they've got no way for him to do anything when it comes to fights. Jump in, jump around. Also removes off if we get the track up on Invoker. His ability to jump in, Viz, and escape. Going the very high movement speed kind of build for Invoker. It's like he's even going to build into a Yule Scepter next. Coming out with the Phase Boots, 4 Staff. Oh, sorry, what I'm saying. Yule Scepter drums is all he's trying to complete up. Yamatar with an Invis rune. Just looking to nuke one person down and make the opening. Ken's here as well, so hasn't finished his BKB. So two semi incomplete BKBs. Lycan is only 200 gold away from it. But while these wolves are on the front lines, they're going to get the cash he needs to finish it. Nice four staff down, but he's not expecting Yamatar to be here. Wonderful EMP tornado. For more, really.
Dyer's
at the same time, that support was there. Orange able to hold the line. HY now buys his full BKB. What's going to be critical now is if Orange are able to catch him out. Not only for the sake of catching Lycan, but got to remember this Aegis is the Immortal. It's only going to last for another 1 minute. With the changes to 6.75, the Aegis Immortal only lasts for 6 minutes out of the 10. Co-op ulti, it's going to push HY back. Trying to get a last hit and a wolf on the way out, but jumped in Viz just at the last moment. KYXY. Ken's coming down here to see if he can find a gank. He's got a lot of support coming down. Do we have Dust? We've got two sentries on Shadow Shaman. But look at that support coming in tight. Wanting a Ravage. He doesn't need it. He'll just go on Kem. Now he can pop the Ravage if he wasn't a chicken shark. He got his ulti off. Now he's a long way from home. Insatiable hunger from the Broodmother popping off some spiders. Now able to give Ice the double kill as the Windrunner. Lycan. Nice blink up by Yamatar. Needs the sting. Gush is there. Hex happens as well. Tornado gonna fly nicely. EMP. Buys time for the four star, but Yamatar doesn't care. And nice shackle. Perfect tree in the line. Mana Boots trying to give a little bit more to this Queen of Pain so she can blink and do exactly that. But then again, Windrunner's power shot hit first. So Orange kind of knew that MUFC were looking for an opening. But while they were doing so, they ended up getting picked off one by one. The trap was there from Orange. And now Venomancer comes in, four star already from Extinct. Just looking to see if anyone was even semi-close enough to be picked up with Telekinesis. But they're not. Lycan's forced to return back to HYHY is just pushing out that bottom lane. And this claimed the tier 1 tower, but that's all he's going to be claiming. As a level 2 ultimate, and as well as that BKB, will be forced to use it in a moment. Or will they? Nope, Orange is going to fall back and be safe about it. It's the worst timing for Lycan as well. That Aegis the Immortal was just reclaimed. Doesn't mean Roshan respawns yet. It just means it's been reclaimed. Ken looking for any kind of lucky track he can get. Wants to know what's happening on the map. KYXY, you can follow him. But by the time they get there, the track will wear off. Yamata. How's he looking? Mystic Star from the ultimate orb, so in 50 gold. This easy camp in here, he'll have his Scythe of Vice. Surprised he doesn't just click it down. Is he going to take mid lane? Okay, he's going to take mid lane. One right click in mid lane, and there's his Scythe of Vice. So now he got Sheep Stick up on Yamata. And this is going to be critical now, especially up against Lycan. Get that quick blink in. Get the Hex out in him, BKB will never pop. And you got to do it before he can even pop his ultimate. Yeah, in fact, the ulti is down. And Yamatar will take this as an opening. Already got some decent mana regeneration. 11.5 points per second. And now with the bottle, crank it up. Once he gets to full mana. Push out the lane. He's letting Ice to spam his out. And we got Arcane Boots, both on cooldown. In fact, all three on cooldown. But the pings, all they want to do is just force that middle lane. And rightly so, HYHY has been doing what he can to add some side lane pressure. But the rest of MUFC, they know without Lycan they cannot defend this. And they need him there on the front lines. And in we come, Shackle won't latch. Nice force stuff there by O'Reilly. Getting himself out of that position for the Shackle. And now Meteorite trying to get rid of the spiders or whatever it possibly can. And Ice is just focusing down, bringing down that barracks. And now BKB flew in as well for Broodmother during the middle of this fight. And Lycan looking to have a go, and whoops, Courier, you went out a little bit too far. One donkey on the deck. Lycan, Shackle, latches, they want a pound on him, but Forstar pulls him out. And both that as well as the Ravage. Sharky will still take a fall, because he's already up before that point. And Shadow Shaman's Wars, they're fighting too close to it. Now the gem taken. And destroyed. So they cannot see Ken anymore. But wonderful four star saving Lycan's life. Pushing him out of the line of fire. Without that four star, it would have been a very, very different fight. But they're still searching for HYHY. I don't think he realized that Rubik stole track. And now he will. He's shackled and instantly killed. That perfect vision of him and HYHY buys back into the game instantly. Realizing with that middle racks down, he needs to be alive to keep the control of the momentum in the middle lane. Now Ice is forced to buy a gem. I say forced. He's got 3.5k gold up his sleeve. It's not that bad. Now he's gonna make sure they don't lose this gem. Another 10 minutes before they can buy another one now. Tracker's out and he steals Cold Snap. As Ken goes in for Roshan, Spire's already having a little bit of fun with Rosh. Yamatar's looking for an opening. Kind of hoping that MUFC are going to send someone down the Roche pit to just jump in and nuke them. But not really going to be the scenario. MUFC trying to be a little bit more defensive and elusive up next to their secret shop. Staying as close as they can. While Lycan again split pushing. So it goes inside the trees, realizes a lot of them are missing. Do they have vision up anywhere around this region? One Venomancer Ward is watching it. And HYHY just holding his TP back for now. Wants to keep this pressure on the bottom lane for as long as possible. Net still wants to have a crack. That's difficult to do. Queen of Pain just keeps adding pressure towards that middle lane. Not to mention middle lane pressures itself. And KYXY will hold the bottom lane. So Orange, they can wait this one out and push out the bottom lane. Middle lane will push. With just the normal momentum they've got. Oh, looking for the shackle. There goes out Gush. BKB pops off from HYHY. Running around looking for a kill. Thinking about Extinct. Now he'll TP out to safety. Oh, nice ulti to steal. Extinct takes Lycan's ulti. So more wolves. Top lane run away. Yamatar on the retreat. Will be picked up by EMP Tornado. Blinks away instantly though. They were hoping for that Shuri toss from Bounty Hunter to hit. Problem is, with a fall, all the time in the world to make sure you mash that button. Shackle not going to happen from net. And now the push to the tier 3 tower. Bottom lane this time. As ever before, middle lane can push in easy enough. Extinct, there's that 4-star and he tried that before in the middle lane. Didn't find anybody. Now they're going to find the Invoker and even the Shackle to latch him up to the creep. Brings him down, but buyback by the Invoker, BKB. Not enough to keep Broodmother alive for now. They want to get away. Mass Serpent was almost able to trap him down. Tide already popping off that. No, she knew he still got it up his sleeve. He wants to pop that Ravage. Extinct was running around inside that Lycan ulti form again. Another Grey Shackle from Ice. So Quap can then do that with the ultimate. So much damage against MUFC. There's your Ravage. Not enough to get a kill still. Gem of True Sight, another one being dropped. And MUFC, they're going to repel Orange. HYHY is really strong. The Shackle will be a mini stun. There's enough time to run away. Rubick with that ultimate is able to escape. Queen of Pain blinking to safety back in towards the middle lane. Which again is pushing. And no, really. Ohio, sorry. I gotta stop calling him O'Reilly. Ohio. Like Ohio. No. Ohio. Why do I keep calling him O'Reilly? Go figure. Alright, Roshan time now. HYHY gonna find himself with another Aegis of the Immortal. As well as more gold and more experience. MUFC. They're currently 10,000 behind, and I was almost looking to call them out GG when their top lane just failed so badly. But then Lycan. Maybe he's still viable. They're trying to run him on the lane. It didn't work, but then he got early levels and then got himself inside the jungle. And then now trying to body block Extinct with those walls. The walls will keel over and die though. Four staffing down, trying to catch up in time. Need that body block to last a little bit longer for Lycan. And then they could have found themselves an opening. Of course, the biggest problem right now for MUFC is the fact they lost that mid-racks And there's no set counter pusher. And if this kind of stuff happens, then they're in trouble. Sharky, nice four-star. Perfect timing there from Net. Realizing he's going to be pulled back down again. So when the pull started to happen, he instantly four-staffed him. And that cancels the pullback. It's frustrating that one ability can be completely countered with just a relocation. The relocation spell can be countered. So half of the ability, half the reason for it, can be countered with just one item, the four staff. Yamantar still enjoying that top lane, up to 3.2k gold on him now. Guess getting bigger and bigger and bigger. But his team is not. It's the experience is telling us a very, very different story about how this game is rolling. And the goal can happen. You got Bounty Hunter on your team. If you have the experience levels in your team, levels, hero levels in your team, you can do so much more. Four-staffing him away. Like him wanting to chase, but like an ulti beam pop for no reason. Hal happened as well, and Ken comes in looking for the track, and there goes again like it's ultimate from Horn Extinct. Nice level 3 ultimate, KYXY, BKB will pop. Gonna do no damage to anybody. Shackle attempted there from Ice, then wonderful hit in. Gonna get the Ravage out, they want to get the kill on Ned, but the Melt Wards, oh, nope, didn't trap off Ice, thought it might have for a moment. The mech will pop. And Brewmother's on the run. Problem for him is he's completely tracked, so he's going to go down. Nice shackle at the last moment. The gem's on the deck again. Ken looking to pick it up or destroy it. Can't get in close enough. I don't think he can. He can't beat up. The wards are trapped up the gem. Now Quap. Wonderful long from Yamata. But will he be able to follow it up? There's three heroes around him. Shackle won't latch again here by Ice. And now he's going to get tornadoed up. Same time he pops the wind run four stamps away. But evasion saving his life for now. And Yamata looking for a scream sting. They're going to dive his tier 2 tower. They want him to take some damage, but MUFC just keep going on it. Yeah, Banyan is calling it out. The Gem of True Sight is still on the deck. Question is, do they destroy it? Sharky will come and pick it up.
Radiant structures are fortified.
Trouble. HY. Overstaying is welcome. Gonna pop the Aegis, the Immortal, because of that. Is there gonna be another pickup? There goes the ultimate. Turns around, trying to kill off Extinct. Might, should be able to do so. In fact, does do so. Now even Yamata. Scream to happen, HY, TPing out. But Blink, as well as Gush, goes on Sharky. He overstays welcome, dropping the gem. And then denying it as well. Just so it cannot be given back to over to Orange. Realizing his death was ensured. 20 to 16 now up on the board. And should be even a higher peak for MUFC, yep. Or Valley, if you look at the graph this way. It's racking up the experience. And there's that goal, which is also catching up. Remember these track kills, especially in 5v5. Just so much money, so much bonus gold you get. It's not just the bonus gold that goes directly to Bounty Hunter. It's the bonus gold for everybody that stands around the kill. So it pays to work in pairs, or in this case, packs. I'm wondering how long it's going to take for Broodmother to finally buy that butterfly. And I think I might have my answer. Has the farm for it. So at least has a little bit of evasion up her sleeve. Already had the increase in damage. So it's the stability during fights, and only through the BKB. We've seen something more. MUFC, they can repel their base quite easily now, as long as Mass Serpent wards are up. And the track lets them prepare a good position for it. And Assault Cuirass is finished on the Lycan as well. HY is getting bigger and bigger. Still 40 minutes in, you got BKB and AC. You won't say it's the Lycan we're used to seeing. There's definitely an effective hero on the map. Ohio's gonna be a little bit cautious there in the middle lane. Sentry wards everywhere for the Radiant side. So managed to get a die ward up pretty nicely up here. give good vision of that top rune and the movement of Orange. See when they're pushing at the lane, see when they're doing, well, when they're looking for ganks in that middle lane. They've got semi-vision, know when they're going to move in for it. It's got no vision once they get in. Bottom lane, HY, just starts up on the tower. Howland just beating it down. Four star fear managed to get the hex on KYXY. Shackled up to Yamatar, BKB to pop. Quapaldi is holding him for the moment. Blinks himself away to safety. HY moves targets. Going to get picked up. He's going to be thrown back down again. Ravage on top of the Quapaldi. Still not enough damage. Ty goes down. Broodmother limping back to base. Ice tries to stand its ground up against a BKB and Invoker. But unable to do so. Tier 2 tower goes down. And now MUFC fall back. They're down by one melee racks, but they keep on winning these small little skirmishes. Plus holding their own lanes. Ken's trying to lay this middle lane. Buying some time for Sharky as well as Ohio to deal with this middle lane. Ice, that's Sheepstick. Yep, so we've got double Sheepstick now for Orange. Big when it comes to the fights, but actually it's not even big when it comes to the fights as such. Because you've got so many BKBs on MUFC's side that it doesn't make a huge amount of difference. It's big when it comes to picking off. Catch one hero out of position. Just one hero out of position. And he can chain hex it. And that should give them enough time to do the damage they need to bring him down. KYXI will give that pressure towards the bottom lane. Roshan should be returning again soon. Yeah, 2.5 minutes. And then he'll return. Ken, that trike is such a pain in the ass for Broodmother. Does not want to have to deal with that. Invis is her weapon. Invis is her maneuverability. And the ability to farm anywhere on the map without being ganked. That's also another top thing. Oh, Yamatar, random position for him. Kind of feels like that SB positioning that we saw yesterday. Gonna find a nice invis rune. So can initiate, do a little bit of damage to HY, and then just jump back out again with an invis. 3.7k gold for HY. Do we see him go heart? Do we see him go damage item now? Yamatar coming in. The wolves ran through, and Yamatar's gonna know HY is in there. They need support. Well, then again, maybe he won't. Just keep on him. HY showing himself on the top lane. But wait, try and bait out that TP. And then follow up with the Hex. Or maybe they're going to start with the Hex. All they can really do. Quops really put the Omen. HY down to half life. Shackle, Ice just too slow. But Yamatar's in front looking for the body block. But you can't block a wolf of that speed. And then BKB, TP out. Right click damage will be nowhere near enough. But both BKB as well as Ultimate Force are being used by there by Lycan. And look at the cooldown on it. 40 seconds. Every 40 seconds he can pop that ultimate. So he doesn't care too much. As MUMC will prep to bring down this tier. Well, actually, it's not even going to be tier 2. It's the only lane they can push through and do damage to a tier 3. Because the tier 2s are still up on the top in the mid lane for Orange. Usher now for Broodmother, so building up to that Manta style. Little by little, the items are arriving. MUFC, they want this tier 3 tower, should be able to take it. At this point, for Orange to defend, it's going to pop off everything and have the best dot combo of their life. But it's all delaying here, MUFC. Roshan's respawned, so they'll jump in and they will quickly take care of him. Medallion was sold by Lycan so he could buy the Assault Cuirass. So they won't have this time. Also probably realize too, the Medallion, the problem of having it is just the damage which then you are able to take. Having that amplified is never a great thing. It's Razor. Gonna move into Razor. MUFC. We'll have to defend the middle lane as Orange move in there. Nope, they're going to smoke up and actually rotate up towards the top lane. Look for one hero out. They would love HYHY, but they're going to go instead. Get rid of the bounty under the guy with the track. Shaq will be mini, but then Cheese to pop. So Cheese does go, but Broodmother's in the middle of it all. Able to right-click down the bounty hunter. There's that damage out from the Battle Fury, from the Butterfly. Now KYXY, a little bit of trouble, four-starving him away. And then Shackled and Death. So they get rid of the Cheese. Very last-minute track by Ken. Probably still gave him the bonus gold. Orange on the run out. Just hiding in the middle lane. TP's got to come back. There's a range Rax to defend. And that's what Orange were banking on. So they bait out the gem. They don't pop the Aegis of the Immortal and they lose the Broodmother for it. So bait out the Cheese. Don't lose the Aegis. That's tier 2 tower on the top lane. MUFC will line themselves up to push it. There's a 4-staff down again from Extinct. Running away this time instead of initiating. But Tidehunter would love MUFC to push right now. He's got Blink Ravage that he wants to use. Shackle misses, however. HYHY turned into a chicken, but he's a very fast chicken in that ultimate form. And Ken searching out for Winter. There's the pickup on the HYHY. Blink up. Nope, not going to be worth the Ravi. He's too far away. Or maybe not. HYHY is right next to him now. Scream and BKB. Remember, Aegis the Immortal is up on HYHY, and they could not stop that TP out. Now Basher being built up, Abyssal Blade to follow. The Lycanthrop. More and more money coming his way. And almost, in fact, he has basically caught up to Queen of Pain and almost caught up to Broodmother. But it's going to be his net worth only just behind the Queen of Pain. Still, a lot of it is just HYHY. Banyan is doing good setups. Invoker, always great for combo abilities. And Shadow Shaman and Venomancer provide very, very little to this team. Trying to find a Hex wherever they can. I say very, very little, and still Shadow Shaman is able to afford a BKB. And Orange, they're running out of time for this game. They've got to push themselves in. If they don't take this second Rax, they'll never stop MUFC. MUFC will just keep pounding on their door. But if it also fails, they're going to lose a large portion of their team. And with that, it will be a counteracting pretty fast. We know the pushing speed that can come out from Lycan. KYXY. I'm in a little bit of trouble. HYHY is just chasing him down. Pops even the BKB for this one. Realizing Extinct is here. And then Extinct just doesn't care. He pops Lycan's ulti. Still had that for a while. With a low cooldown, is perfect for Extinct. Able to really get in there. And now, maybe. Nope. I think you're fighting Venomancer Bashaki. Able to juke it out. Well, it's going to be a 5v5 fight in the bottom. Maybe we still got that blink to Ravage. And one BKB's on cooldown. HYHY's BKB's on cooldown, even though he's got Abyssal Blade. He's got 17 seconds left on that BKB. Ken should be available. Yeah, it is. He's only got a 6-second BKB, though. 6-second BKB, got a 5-second BKB, and Invoker is an 8-second BKB. It's like Sunstrike was just looking for an opening on something. I'm really going to find it. Everyone on Orange is in pretty good shape. Forty-nine minutes in. And both teams really cautious to go in. It's one team fight. And it's basically over, really. One team fight. If Orange win it, they can push in. Because they've already taken out mid-Rax. So rotating in and taking out the bottom lane shouldn't be too difficult for them. The problem they have is if they lose a fight, even though they have tier 2 towers up, and as well as the tier 3 tower in the bottom lane, MUFC are able just to get in so easily. Oh, a little bit of trouble. Shackle up on here on Ohio. Winter forced after way, trying to get away from that EMP. Neck charge, then blink in from Yamata. Ulti as well misses on everything. Oh, this could be some trouble. 35 seconds, and instantly Orange have to fall back. The BKBs are on cooldown, and the tracks have already got good vision. I'm able to latch the shackle on top of that. Monkey King by now comes out from Queen of Pain. So we're starting at the right click damage from Queen of Pain. Realizing they're missing a decent chunk of that. MUFC. HYTWINET. Still wanting to keep that pressure on the bottom lane. They know how important it is that if they do manage to win a fight, they're able to follow through with it. Not to mention, Aegis has already popped. Let's just reclaim it. But it's already at that point. We got 4 minutes until Roshan. Yamata. Really surprising he missed that ultimate. Oh, Hex, bottom lane, it's KYXY. Sun Strike perfectly on target as well. Lycan able to bring him down. Now in towards the middle lane. Ken's the one being hexed up. A BKB will pop and he wants to turn around to fight this. He's already got double track. And very, very luckily for Rubik. Actually, no. Not luckily at all. He saw the wrong ability. He didn't want that. He wanted track. And the escape mechanism is not what he needs. Obviously, it's not bad. But what he needs and what his team needs is vision. And you know what's happening with MUFC, where they're moving on the map. How are they farming? Where's that Bounty Hunter in comparison to us? And Bounty also, a little bit of a different build. There's a Ravage on bottom lane, but there was no point. The double BKBs were up. It had absolutely no effect whatsoever. And there's the crit and bash. HYHY now on a mega kill streak. And the calls are coming. Push out the top, push out the bottom. Many different options. Now Xig will try and hold the lines. There's Wolves there. Shackle unable to latch from Ice. They're starting to attack on top of the tower. Ken's coming in as well. Four staff in. The net will still get the Hex out and extinct. Tornado as well. Coming out from the Invoker. Missing on everything. Actually, no. Whoop, doesn't look like it picked up extinct. It's a little bit further at the back though. And then tier 3 tower's gone. Shackle again unable to latch. The track continues. Middle lane will be the next focus, but bottom rank's completely gone. They cannot contest it when they got both Tide as well as Queen of Pain down. They need both their ultimates. Even then, when Tide is back up again now, his ulti is still on cooldown for over a minute. And that should be more than enough time for MUFC to almost force this middle lane. There goes the Tornado flying out. MUFC. They will bring down this tier 3 tower in the mid. In fact, it has now done so. And looking a little bit deeper, they're going to go for the melee racks. Their fortification to slow it down. No, there's not. There's just them not attacking on it. Winter's already gone down, so Titan is on the sideline. Firepower ulti, that's a little bit better. Able to pick up the Venomancer. Instantly tracked, however. And then the Hex to follow up on the Bounty Hunter. And this is dangerous times. Overextension for MUFC. While they did just manage to take two melee racks, they still have the problem that this mid lane can have a lot of momentum. And MUFC, they've got that range racks they can bring down. That'll shift the momentum in the middle lane. Top lane is being defended, and Tide's the only one down. And when he comes back up again, he'll have ulti. So MUFC, if they push fast enough, they can go straight down that middle lane. Their problem is now going to be the bottom lane. You want to push straight down middle lane, but you can't do so because you're always being pressured now by Mega Creeps in the bottom lane. It's not going to stop Yamata from farming and pushing him back. It's not a bad use of an ultimate as well. Cooldown's not that long. So I may as well just keep spamming it out. Smoke time now from Orange. I know Roshan's up. In fact, he's coming up in just a couple of seconds. The timing is right. In fact, the timing is horrible for MUFC. Invoker and Bounty Hunter are still different on the 15 seconds. And they're going to walk straight into the pit. The Wolf, sitting outside the pit, hasn't gone in. The web does pop, and that's going to reveal the fact that, yes, Orange are inside, but if they can get this Roshan, it's going to be so critical for them. Tide Ravage is still available for them, and they're going to claim it. Right underneath the nose of MUFC. Wonderful play there by Orange, and that's going to keep them in this game. I say keep them in it. Can you actually know they came from 11,000 behind to bring it 8,000 back MUFC? Even the experience never really went too far against them. 4K is still pretty bad. But 12,000 was the advantage now going the way of MUFC at its highest point. Nice, doing whatever he can to hold this bottom lane. They do have the Aegis as well as the Cheese, and this is the crucial thing. So Cheese up on the Broodmother. Mandastyle has been finished on him. Rubik's the one walking around with the gem, so look for him as far as position goes. Look out for that Bounty Hunter. And you can see Mortal, of course, put up on the big right-click damage dealer, plus the magical damage dealer, plus the Hexer. That's going to be the Queen of Pain. MUFC starts their own preparations. Adding some wards to the high ground. They want to know when Orange come out. And Yamata, oh, BKB popped off from both. But you know that right click damage from Yamata is going to be enough. Good Ravage, going to buy a little bit of time. Queen of Pain, now's the time for your Ullman. There's a good line for everybody. Or can they do it? There's the Quapoldi, going to go straight through the Broodmother. However, it's going to be HY. HY's going one to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next. Mine back out by Rubik. And you're going to see Mortal also going to have a respawn happen. Extinct, pick up, stall Howl, give some bonus damage. It's going to be enough for KYXY. Maybe to bring down HYHY with the silence, and Yamata comes in to finish the job. Like an instant buyback. The gem still up on the high ground, and the wards not denying it, allowing Extinct to re-pick up the gem, even though it was the mass serpent wards there of Shadow Shaman. So just a little bit of lack of control. The problem Orange have is they want to push up the middle lane, but they've already had Lycan buy back, and this is happening in the bottom lane. Yeah, pings are happening. They've got to fall back. They must fall back, and wisely so. Because if they didn't, well, they would have themselves a lot more riches because they would have beat MUFC looking to gank him up. But HYHY, now with Demon Edge, with enough money to buy up a Monkey King bar, and may as well, his buyback's on cooldown, so spend the cash, man. Extinct wants to hold them off in the middle lane. Ravage on cooldown for another minute. And a bit. It's going to be too long. And then the Roshan timer can start all over again. Aegis popped pretty early in all of that. The Cheese was not used, however. So KYXY not having to sacrifice that. Maybe Queen of Pain will take it, but then again, Queen of Pain, 5.7k gold. Interesting to see what item she goes next. Do we see her go the crit? Does she go Daedalus? Or do we see her go more of a tanking item? We can look towards Heart. We can look towards Shiva's Gun. Mjolnir. It is going to be Daedalus. It's going to be first item I said. So I start off with a Crystallis. In fact, yeah, has enough money. Has enough money to buy the entire thing, but will have no buyback if she does do so. So just keeps with the crit for now. The wolves are right on top of Yamata. And a couple of illusions just to screw with them as well. Ohio. Looking for a small opening with a tornado, but wasn't really going to find it. Just more a wishful tornado. Queen of Pain is going to move up towards the top lane, and they'll get rid of this creep wave. It's already got a decent amount of momentum given to it. Orange not really able to control that top lane, even though the racks are equal. KYXY forced to control this bottom lane. We'll have to look towards the mid. Upside for Orange. This battle's about to begin, and they've got a ton of Ravage. The downside is if he's going to die early on. Lycan just prancing himself up towards that top. MUFC on the top racks now. Put pressure on Orange from all sides. Best way they can go about it. Guys, what are you guys on about inside the chat? It's a Crystalis. Well, I think actually other people call it Crystalis. Depending where you're from. That's what you guys talk about the chat. I don't even know what you guys are on about sometimes. You guys just like taking the shit out of everything. It's good.
Invisibility.
BT's on that like, and it's just so easy for him to split push. Not to mention his movement speed. Fastest boots in the game, as far as movement speed goes, more bonus-wise. Orange looking for an opening. All they want to do is find that opening. There's one player from MUFC coming out too fast. The reason why they're smoked up as far as they are and not pushing out the lanes. But MUFC are going to realize that. No one's pushing out the bottom lane. There's no one in the middle lane, and there's one hero on the top lane holding the lines. While this happens, Kang just gives some momentum to the bottom lane. Orange are wasting too much time looking for an opening. Either they force it, they find it, or they fall back and keep their lanes pushed. We're also going to keep taking damage inside their own base. They definitely have a need to push out. And have a need to also not push out one by one. Barizia is actually a Dota 1 thing. It's the old name for Daedalus. For the guy in the chat that just talked about that. If it is also that game thing. It's like, meh. Cool, fantastic. Stolen. Hex. Thought I heard one of those out in the map. Keeping my ears pricked for initiation, but no one was even close for it. And Yamata. This is nice for him in the middle lane. There's some good momentum on that middle creep wave. And now you'll see if you can find that 62-minute rune, which spawns on bot double damage as well. What the f- Yeah, okay. Go with that. Top lane. Trouble. Rubik's already dead. Invoker just melts him with the help of Lycan. BKB has popped off from Lycan. And Rubik, you're going to hope at this point you got buyback, man. But no, he does not. He's short of gold. And now HY. Chicken, mini shackle, trying to get himself back out of here. The ulti's going to wear off. They should be able to bring down HY right now. Yes, they do so. Queen of Pain Allman able to finish up the job. Now over onto Sharky. And this insatiable hunger from Broodmother is enough. Now he's going to go. Perfect Ravage from Winter right in the middle of MUFC. Lycan again will buy back. Gem is dropped on the deck. So we can go back and pick that one up. But that's now the time for Queen of Pain to finish that Daedalus. And get back into base. Push out this creep wave again. And look to Roshan in 2 minutes' time. It's too long. And we have to see we'll be back alive by that point. But another buyback being used by Lycan. Kind of understandable as well. He's not going to be using his money to buy anything else. He's already maxed out his items. He can get rid of Vlad's if he wants to. But to buy another tier 3 item will risk his buyback. He doesn't want to do that. Now he's going to find Winter. Oh, man! Just destroys the Tidehunter. Will now also find all the farm of the Spiderlings. He's doing 1k crits with that double damage. Ken looking for the courier. And the courier's going to pick up the gem in the end. So his team, again, are able to hold onto a gem. This is still game one of a best of five grand final. For the ESWC qualifiers, East qualifier. Because we are running it here at joindota.com, and this is your English live stream for JoinDota. Track from Ken. Doesn't care if he reveals himself, it's as long as he's able to see Windrunner and see what's happening inside the base. While that track is on, there's no option for a smoke. There's no option for anything. That's Queen of Pain looking, so Daedalus is done. And now we'll see right-click damage. He's also doing 1k crits, and that's without a double damage rune. He'd love to go on HY. If he's got Extinct to support him, it's going to be perfect. Yeah, they're going to see him on top lane. This could be a big blunder now if HYHY can go down. There's the blink in. Instant Hex, Quap ulti. Gotta pick him up with telekinesis. Use that time for the right click. His ulti is there, and will it be enough now if he gets the kill on Rubick very, very quickly? But Yamata will take him, and then you will not want to be here. Is there a Hex? So it's on. Yeah, so it's still on cooldown. And the gems on the ground. The Lycan Wolf again, not able to focus and kill it off. In fact, that belongs to Rubick, Yamata, gem. That's why the courier's on the way up. Gonna pick it up. At the same time, KYXY able to find one hero out of position. It's gonna be Ken. Where is it gonna be? No, they can't see him. They got no gem on him. And then the track onto Winter. Tornado gonna fly through. Broodmother could be in a little bit of trouble, but at the same time, Yemitar's on the hunt. All he wants is one hero. They're using the wolf that he managed to steal off Lycan to scout. And there's the initiation on from Yamata. Right click, already picking off Net. Yamata at least leaves the gems on the deck. He just does not care. And Ohio. I would like to know where he is, but they cannot see him. He's managed to steal the haste rune. That gem is still on the ground. Somebody picked the damn thing up. Oh, what the hell is that? Oh, it's back in base. It's Extinct who's going to defend. And now top lane, Sharky on the run, but Yamata, nice four-star away from Sharky, but not going to avoid Yamata. He's just picking off one hero after the other of MUFC. They're not grouping up as five anymore. And now Invoker, Sunstrike can be perfect, going to bring down Ice. But buyback out from Windrunner. KYXY plus Yamata. The middle lane creep wave is pushed in, so that's the reason why they're able to do this. Fortification slowing them down. Yamata wants to get rid of the creep wave, and now Melee Rax, BKB, gonna pop off from the Invoker. Want to run straight through. You can think about Ken, but a lot of damage from Ken being done to KYXY. You'll have to use the cheese in the end, but they've taken out the top Melee Rax. Cole snapped up, but the Rax still goes down. And buyback by the Broodmother. Everybody's retreating back out again. So now there's two Raxes being done. And Dire's creep, Dire's courier, able to pick up that gem. Power shot through. And we'll see Roshan coming out of his pit. So Orange knows he's back up again and would love to take him. So now Orange, they've got the control over the top lane as far as Rax. Middle lane, it's even. Both teams still maintain their range Rax. But bottom lane, MUFC have both melee as well as range Rax. So it's only one range Rax favor going away of MUFC. And the question is still going to come back to buybacks. Queen of Pain's got enough cash for one. That's already spent a lot of money. So Mana Style, fully maxed. Fully maxed Yamata. And you'd expect that 67 minutes into this game. It just keeps going. It just keeps going. Now 33 to 30. Have we even... We've gone down, we've gone up. Managed to reverse a 12k experience deficit. But then MUFC also managed to pull back 4k, and then the gold advantage. Jumping down to 8k and then coming back up again. There's that Sunstrike scouting it out, and I'll see a copy of Windrunner in there. I don't even think it's the real one, but it's not. That's the rest of Orange are searching. Where is the opening? Where is the gem? There's a gem on Rubick. And Bounty Hunter just saw it too. So very, very wisely not going in close. KYXY is going to give some momentum towards the bottom lane. And this is a lot easier for MUFC. I mean for Orange, or maybe not. Man, they can force this. MUFC, you better have TPs. TPs, TPs, TPs. There we go. Everyone's got to get back. Ken's in the base. Walking straight past the Tide, and Extinct can see him. There's the Hex already starting off. Coming from the Invoker. Fortification going to stop that barracks from going down straight away. Queen of Pain wanting to save that Alderman just in case. They've already pulled the aggro off, but these wolves are doing too much damage. They've got to stop this range rash from going down, losing even more control. But it's already too late. Range rash gets sniped. Whoop, bottom lane. Oh, Ken. 44 HP. What is the chance you'll get away with 44 bloody HP? And then TP's back out to safety. Back to base to heal. And Orange, they've managed to repel the push from MUFC. The question is, can they get in there and finish off Roshan quick enough? Get that Aegis the Immortal and cheese again. Get rid of the walls, but MUFC will know this is going to happen. I don't know if we've got track up on anybody. No, we do not. But already Forge Spirit scouting out. Roshan being done off and will it be enough. They've already silenced him up with the Orchid. Yamatar's trying to do enough damage. There's a nice EMP and in comes HY. HY already killing up Yamatar. Big kill. Bionic will be there. Venomously from Better Ultimate in the middle of everyone. Now the Ravage to pop will buy some time. Yamatar's ult is on cooldown for the moment. He's just right clicking down Sharky. Now Ken, as well as Annette, has managed to hold Yamatar in position. Oh, this is going to be GG. Winter, the only one alive for now. Shackle, perfectly done from Ice. But Queen of Pain dead. She bore back to be part of that without Quop. I do not see Orange defending this. It's a double kill for the Bounty Hunter. And Ice will also go down. Wars to block and trap. And everyone is dead for Orange. And everyone is alive for MUFC. There's the Lion Beast. Like, get this creep wave through, would ya? You? You're not going to have no time. MUFC are going for the GG. And that is going to be Tier 4 Towers to take the fall. And then the Radiance Ancient. First game out of the best of five is going to go the way of MUFC. 70 minutes and 56 seconds. With the way this is going to be turning out, we could be here for a very, very long time. But if it's total like this, hey, I'm going to be happy about it. We'll be back here in a couple of moments' time. Game number two of the ESWC qualifiers for the East. We'll be back.